Please turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 58 as we come to the end of our four-week fasting practice. And stand with me for the reading of Scripture. There's a Bible in front of you, in the seat in front of you. It's page 790 if you need one. Let me give you just a short moment to breathe and collect yourself. And you may just want to offer a prayer in the quiet of your heart. Just offer all that you are to all God is before we open our heart to receive. Isaiah chapter 58, let's read from verse 6. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke. To set the oppressed free and break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." Take a seat. Sarah is a new mother here in LA, and due to a number of reasons, sadly, she is all alone in this season of her life. The dad is out of the picture. Like many in the city, she's just trying to scrape by with cost of living here, and recently she paid her utilities for the month and rent, but has $0 left over to buy groceries. And she's a new Christian. And in her own faltering, still trying to figure it out way, she stopped and she asked God for help and would say she just felt a strange peace come over her. The next morning, out of the blue, she opened her front door, and there on the stoop of her apartment were bags of groceries and an envelope with old school cash in it, anonymous. No idea where it's from, but her strong suspicion was it's from her new church. Paul is a business person here at Vintage, and earlier this year, he found out that the Salvation Army, where Vintage volunteers host a weekly dinner for our houseless neighbors. Anybody in the room? Any of you who do that? No? Okay. There were a lot at the first gathering. Okay, here we are. Not you. Well, now this sermon will be very helpful for you, everyone. And he found out earlier this year that the Salvation Army lost its funding for that weekly outreach dinner. And around the same time, he had a business deal come through that went very well, and he felt a strong sense that he was to give the payout from that new initiative to fund the initiative at Salvation Army for the remainder of the year. He was moved by something Gare said in a teaching, and then he found out that the payout was the exact same amount as the budget shortfall for the rest of the year. And he took that as a sign from God that he was to give. Connie is a regular guest at that same Thursday night dinner. She's become friends with Kirk. I don't actually know Kirk. I got this from the staff. He sounds like a great dude. Maybe you're here, Kirk. He is a volunteer from Vintage. And recently, you know, she's not well and requires the use of a kind of four-legged walker and recently was stolen on the street. And he was just moved with compassion for her, and he bought a new one for her. And they remain friends to this day and regularly share a meal together. I tell you about Connie and Kirk and Paul and other people because, you know, as a general rule, stories move us far more than statistics. But the statistics are still haunting, and most of you know this. Around 2 billion people in the world live in poverty, and around 10% of the global population, or that's about 700 or 800 million people, live in extreme poverty on less than $2 a day. Here in America, the extreme poverty rate is actually higher than the global median at 11.6%. That's nearly 40 million people in our country. You see this in our generation's particular epidemic of houselessness. California, of course, as you know, and as all of our conservative grandparents remind us, has the highest houselessness rate in the nation, over 180,000 people. 75,000 of that, I'm bad at math, what is that, around 40-ish percent, are here in LA County. And there are 6,000 children here in LA living on the streets any given evening. And yet at the same time, the estimate is that 40% of all food in the United States of America is thrown away as waste. 40%, something like estimates range from 80 to 160 billion pounds of food waste per year. So all of that is just to remind you what you already know. We live in a bizarre moment in human history where millions of people in our country alone go without food or shelter, and millions more have more food than we literally know what to do with, so we throw it away. Is there a practice from the way of Jesus to heal all of this disparity and to move our heart in the right direction? Yes, it is the practice of fasting. Over the last 3 weeks, we have explored the power of fasting for what you could call our spiritual formation. And now we're ready to shift, and this is a bit of an arbitrary distinction, but now we're ready to shift from the internal to the external. And all I mean by that is to the power of fasting to transform not just you and me, but to transform entire churches and even communities. Throughout church history, fasting was one of the core practices that followers of Jesus adopted to move toward those, intentionally toward those, that Jesus called the needy. That could be the poor or the hungry or the fatherless or those on the receiving end of evil and injustice. This is the fourth and final reason behind the practice of fasting. Again, we have covered in the preceding weeks the four major, kind of three of the four major motivations for fasting: to offer ourselves to Jesus, to grow in holiness, and to amplify our prayers. Up next to end is to stand with the poor. And this may be one aspect of fasting that is new to you. You may not think of fasting as a vehicle for the biblical vision of justice, but in the imagination of the biblical writers, it most certainly is. Let's look again at Isaiah 58. Again, there's a Bible in front of you in your seat if you don't have one, because this is one of the most essential passages on fasting in all of the library of Scripture. So over the next few minutes, let's just kind of work through the whole passage line by line. In context, before we start, God is speaking through the prophet Isaiah, kind of 7th, 8th century Hebrew prophet, to the people of Israel, who were intended, if you're new to the Bible, Israel was intended, if you read the story of the Old Testament, to be what was called a kingdom of priests, a channel for the rule and the reign, for the kingdom of God to come back to the earth. Humanity had spiraled wildly out of control in the aftermath of Adam and Eve. And so God called one family, Abraham and Sarah, to become 12 tribes, to become a nation, to become the family of Israel or the children of Israel, to serve as, in the language of the New Testament, a city on a hill, a light to the Gentiles, that's to all the non-Jewish people, to become this portal for heaven to reinvade earth with the kingdom of God. But Israel, if you know the story, was falling woefully short. One of the main reasons was because God's intention was for Israel to model to the watching world a just society. If you've ever read the Torah, it's the first five books of the Bible. It's the part of the Bible most of us avoid. But if you actually read Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy, and most of us need a little help from the Bible Project or somebody smarter than the rest of us to kind of help us get our brain into this ancient setting. But if you actually read it and pay close attention, it is stunning in its beauty. In particular, the laws in the Torah around gleaning, which was a kind of agrarian form of social welfare, interest-free loans, the year of Jubilee, all the first laws around human rights, which originally are all traced back to the Torah itself, not even to the teachings of Jesus, predating that. All of it is way, not just like ahead of its time, it's still, in my opinion, more sophisticated, wise, insightful, grounded in the reality of the human condition, and radical than anything I'm aware of in modern day social kind of geopolitics. And yet, rather than being an exemplar to the nations by following the laws laid out in the Torah, Israel, by Isaiah's time, had become no different than the nations. Enter the prophet. Verse 1, let's read together. Shout it aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. In the literary design of Isaiah's poetry, this is God speaking in the first person to Israel through Isaiah. And he's saying, all right, now I just want you to tell it like it is. Just say it how it is. Verse 2, day after day, they, Israel, seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways. God, we want to know your ways. As if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decisions and seem eager for God to come near to them. Remember last week, all of that kind of conversation around discernment. They discern. They claim they want to know and do the will of God. Come, Holy Spirit, right? But verse 2, why have we fasted, they say, and you've not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? You're not answering our prayer. Nothing seems to be happening. People are asking, we're fasting, but it does not seem to be working. Why is God not hearing our prayer? Verse 3, yet on the day of your fasting, on every Wednesday or whatever, you do as you please. You just kind of do what you want and exploit all your workers. You're tied into this kind of interwebbing of injustice. Your fasting, as a result, ends in quarreling and strife and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. Is this the kind of fast I have chosen? Listen, this is interesting. Only a day for people to humble themselves? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Meaning, fasting is not only to offer ourselves to God, grow in holiness, amplify our prayers. There's more to it. Verse 6, is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, to break, there's a forceful kind of metaphor, break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood. Notice the motivation for this type of fasting is to fight injustice, to free people from oppression, to share your food with the hungry, to provide shelter for refugees, immigrants, and those with no home, to clothe the naked, and to meet the practical needs of your family, your friends, and the people in your community. If you practice this kind of fasting, listen to what will happen. Verse 8, then your light will break forth like the dawn. What a beautiful imagery of a sunrise. Your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory, the presence, and the beauty of God will be your rear guard all around you. Then you will call and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help and he will say, here am I. Can you imagine God just saying, here am I, how can I help? If you do away with the yoke of oppression and with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry, not to spend your money, no, to spend yourselves, your very life, in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. What a beautiful promise. Imagine the Lord will out in front of you, your pastor, to guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land. In a time of drought or blight, he will give you all you need. He will strengthen your frame, breathe vitality into your body. You will be like, remember, these are ancient desert people hearing this, a well-watered garden like a spring whose waters never fail. your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and will raise up the age-old foundations. You will be called something so much cooler than Run JMC. Repairer, everything's cooler than that. But you will be called, and notice it's capitalized, repairer of broken walls, restorer of streets with dwellings. This is a whole other dimension to fasting than the previous three. It has less to do with us and more to do with others, in particular with the poor. Less to do with what we get out of the practice and more with what we give through the practice. In his commentary on this passage in Isaiah 58, St. Augustine, who, if you're new to this whole thing, 4th century, Bishop of Hippo in what's now Algeria, brilliant mind, his legacy is still in effect. In his commentary on Isaiah 58, said this, "Break your bread for those who are hungry," said Isaiah. "Do not believe that fasting," kind of all by itself, "suffices or is enough. Fasting chastises you, but it does not refresh the other." Meaning, just if you just fast on Wednesdays, it does nothing for people around you. "Do you wish your prayer to reach God? Give it two wings, fasting and almsgiving." I love this word picture. Prayer in his imagination is like, it's like a bird, right? And if you want the bird to fly to heaven, you need to give it two wings, fasting and almsgiving. Now, almsgiving, that is not a word we use anymore, unless if you're like super cool, we don't use that word anymore at all. But it is a word used a lot by the biblical writers. It's a word used by Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. It's a word used by all of the early Christians and for hundreds of years into church history. It's very tricky to translate it from either Hebrew or Greek into English. It can be translated almsgiving or works of mercy. Sometimes it's translated charity. It's a combination of a few ideas we have today, certainly generosity, just giving your resources away, but also has these components of like service, like where you would give time, and justice, where you would attempt to right kind of the systems or structures of wrong. And in the biblical imagination, almsgiving is just as tied to fasting as is prayer. So in the same way that it's a bit hard to imagine, like if you're gonna fast this coming Wednesday, it's a bit hard to imagine fasting but not praying. At that point, we're like out of the Christian domain into Huberman world. Not a bad thing, but like it's a little hard to imagine fasting for a day and not praying to Jesus. To the biblical writers, or most Christians through church history, it would be just as weird to think about fasting this coming Wednesday and not giving alms to the poor. They are that tied together. Please keep in mind that modern social services that are an integral part of our society now, particularly with large cities and nation states, for most of human history, all of that work was done, you know, feeding the hungry, caring for orphans and people in need, medicine, hospitals, often shelter for travelers. Most, if not all of that work was done by local churches and local communities, not by the state. You can imagine if we lived in that world. There's all sorts of reasons that it's changed and it's done by the government now. One is honestly just Christian influence on the West. And then the other would just be economies of scale now that we live in such mega kind of cities like LA. But can you imagine if like all of a sudden government social services went away and you had the Bible and we were responsible as a community for, let's just say, 2 square miles around here. We were responsible to meet all pragmatic needs for people here. Can you imagine how much money we would have to raise to do that? We would need to raise millions of dollars. We'd need to buy multiple apartment complexes. We would need multiple staff to run the whole thing. We would need to raise tons of money to take that responsibility back on. You can imagine in an ancient world where the economy is very different, it's not based, you know, on digital numbers like ours is today. You can imagine where if you would get your entire church to fast every Wednesday and every Friday and then take their grocery budget for those days and give it to the poor, that would be a very pragmatic way to raise necessary funding to do the work of God through the church in a city or a place. All of that to say, followers of Jesus have been practicing this type of fasting for a very long time. The Shepherd of Hermas, which is an early Christian writing, it's kind of dated to early second century, so a few years, decade maybe or two after the book of Revelation in the New Testament. In fact, it was seriously considered for canonization in the New Testament. It has this instruction on, by that time already, within a few decades of Jesus' resurrection, the kind of widespread early Christian practice of fasting twice a week until sundown on Wednesdays and Fridays. It has this kind of instruction. Estimate the cost of the food you would have eaten on that day and give that amount to a widow or orphan or someone in need. Be humble in this way, that the one who receives something because of your humility may fill his soul and pray to the Lord for you. Notice that the poor here are not like the object of your pity, and you don't stand above them. Actually, you, if you have extra, you need them to pray for you. The implication is that their prayer is more likely to be heard by God than yours is. St. Gregory of Nyssa, church father a few centuries later, 4th century in Cappadocia in the East, said this of fasting: give to the hungry what you deny your own appetite. Simple, elegant, powerful. Caesarius of Arles in France in the 6th century said this: let us fast in such a way that we lavish our lunches upon the poor, so that we may not store up in our wallets what we intended to eat, but rather in the stomachs of the poor. This is just a small sampling. It's that all of these great ones of the way of Jesus are saying we cannot separate our relationship with God from our relationship with our neighbor. And fasting is a way to love God and our neighbor at the same time. This type of fasting, where you share your food with the hungry, in the language of Isaiah, is a way to do three things. First, it's a way to stand in solidarity with the hungry. Regularly going without food by choice can get us emotionally in touch with the millions of people around the world and in our own country and in our own city who regularly go without food not by choice. The denial of your stomach does something to your heart. Like, this is what's so hard for Western people to get about fasting. I think it's one of the reasons that fasting was central to discipleship and then just disappeared about 200 years ago in the West, not in the global church, is because we're so mind-based as a culture. We can't fathom, like, coming at transformation, not through our mind or a sermon or a book or a podcast or a conversation, but through, like, our stomach. Like, we can't, it's a body-based model of transformation. And the denial of your stomach, it does something to your heart. As you begin to feel hunger in your body itself, you begin to feel the pain, the compassion, and mercy of God. You begin to see the poor not as a stranger and kind of an object of your pity, but as a brother and a sister and an object of your responsibility. I know several families who care a lot about raising kids in our kind of, you know, affluent culture without letting their heart just get warped by the materialism. I mean, I was thinking about that this morning, just driving in, and we live up in the mountains up in Topanga Canyon, and so it's a beautiful drive here, and you're along the PCH. But I was just, beautiful morning, driving in, thinking, I'm still new to this city. We just moved here last summer. I keep asking Gare, like, how are there so many rich people here? Like, the level of wealth, I know there's a lot of poor people here too, but there is a heck of a lot of rich people here. Where does this money come from? And I was just thinking, my kids drive this drive every day to go to school right around the corner from here. How is that not going to warp their heart? Where you just assume, just driving in the cars next to you and what the people look like and how people are living, that it's normal. Like, this is, kids, this is not normal. How do I raise kids in a place like this without letting it just, I mean, Jesus was so clear on money. I hate to break it to you, but he doesn't have a single good thing to say about wealth. Basically, all of his teachings are like, be really careful and give most of it away. That's basically the crass oversimplification of Jesus' teachings on money, which are beautiful, by the way. What he says about money is stunning. That's another sermon for another time. But my point is, like, how do we not let our heart be warped? Well, I know a number of families who just do such a simple practice. They do a rice and beans night once a week where they, as an act of intentional spiritual formation, they eat what most people around the world eat every single night. Just as a simple way of, like, helping their children realize this is what reality is for most people. Fasting or even a restricted diet like that can enable us to stand in solidarity with the needy and the hungry. But also it's a way, secondly, to share what we have with the needy. What we give up in money spent on food can be turned into generosity to the poor. And what we give up in time spent on food, shopping, cooking, eating, cleaning up, meal planning for the next one, all of that can be spent in service of the poor. Dorothy Day, if you're familiar with her, that bohemian intellectual from New York City, had this radical transformation to the way of Jesus and became kind of the founder and most vocal advocate of the Catholic worker movement, said this: "How shall we have the means to help our brother who is in need? We can do without those unnecessary things which become habits." And here's your 1940s examples. Cigarettes. Gary, you should think about giving that up for a while. Liquor, coffee, tea, candy, sodas, soft drinks, and those foods at meals which only titillate the palate. We all have these habits, the youngest and the oldest. I'm looking at that list, I'm like, everything but cigarettes, I'm down. And we have to die to ourselves in order to live. We have to put off the old man and put on Christ. You know, any of you that grew up Catholic, there is a long-standing tradition in the Catholic Church of not just fasting or following a restricted diet on Fridays, but also on Fridays, on the same day, serving that day in a food pantry or a local nonprofit. This is one way to not just talk about justice, but to do justice. I mean, it's literally a social parody. We all know there's so much, of what we now call slacktivism, as it's come to be called, in the digital age. So much of what people name as justice is just ranting on social media, often with a motivation of nothing more than virtue signaling, to try to get somebody else in power to do what needs to be done. And, there's a time and a place for that. Much of that is based on kind of a Hebraic concept of speaking truth to power, sure. But in biblical theology of justice, if Isaiah were here or any of the Hebrew prophets who basically started this movement, I think they would all say, listen, talk is cheap. The call is to act in love. Think of 1 John chapter 3 is a famous line in the New Testament if you're new to the Bible. This is how we know what love is. Right? We hear the word love all of the time. It's so overused. It's practically meaningless. Here's what it means in the New Testament imagination. Jesus Christ laid down his life. That's the definition of love according to the New Testament. To give your life and sacrifice for the good of another. To let life come to others through your death. And we, and here's the natural follow-up, as apprentices of Jesus, we ought to follow his example, to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters, for the family of God. If anyone, and here's the example, here's how we do this at a pragmatic level. If anyone has material possessions, you have extra, you have more than you need, and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. It's easy to stand here, and particularly on a concept like this, just think, what can one person do in the face of all of the evil and injustice in the world? Well, one person like you or like me or one community like us can do this. We can fast and free up our resources to share with those in need. I mean, it could literally be as simple as you fast every Wednesday and you give the $20 you would have spent on Chipotle or, Erewhon lunch, $95, whatever. I'm learning the LA ways, by the way. we were literally at Erewhon recently for a date night. And we'd never been there before. We've been hearing about this legendary place. It was unbelievable, by the way. And it was actually doable for a date night picnic. It wasn't too bad. And we get up to the cash register and this very cool looking person is trying to sell us on a membership to Erewhon. And my wife is so down to earth. She is so not like that. And she just goes, I'm sorry, but we have three teenagers. We won't be shopping here. We're just here on date night. It was awesome. I was just like, you're awesome, woman. Oh, my goodness. So whatever it is, wherever you shop, wherever you fall in that socioeconomic spectrum, it can literally be as simple as just giving up that money that you would have spent on breakfast and lunch and just donating it to the Salvation Army or your local food bank or someone in need in your community or Venmoing somebody in your that you know in your circle of care or in your family itself or whatever it is to pay medical bills or hit utilities or whatever it is. It's that simple. But it is far more powerful than most of us realize. See, this is what I think happens. Most of us read the news in the morning and we just feel powerless against the staggering weight of evil and injustice right here in our own country, much less the world. Let me just nerd out on you for 2 minutes. We're learning each other. I will waste a couple minutes of your time here, and I will probably waste a lot more than that, but let me just nerd out on you for a minute. The social critic Neil Postman, any of you ever read him, has said some really helpful things about the impact of TV and entertainment industry on Western culture. And he actually argues that a turning point in Western culture was the invention of the telegraph, way before like the iPhone or Wi-Fi or the internet. He actually says it's the telephone that had a profound impact on how we interact with evil. Because prior to the, telegraph. Prior to the telegraph, I don't even know what year that was. And keep your phone away. I don't need to know. But we'll Google it later. 150 years ago, whenever that was. Bad news from around the world could kind of sort of filter to you, but it would be very limited and it would take a long time. So if you're living in California 150 years ago and war broke out in Israel, Palestine, or Ukraine, Russia, you would not even know about it until 2 or 3 months later. And if you could read, which wasn't very likely, you would read it like maybe one article in a newspaper while you're sitting there with your family or friends or whatever. Now, with the invention of the telegraph, was the first time that bad news from anywhere in the world could quickly come to you anywhere in the world. And the reason this created psychosis was prior to that, most of the bad news that, first off, you were exposed to way less bad news. And when you were exposed to bad news, it was normally in your actual community where you had some modicum of influence to do something about it. So bad news was more like Joe's barn's on fire. And like I think of the old Westerns, like what would you do? You'd like run out in your like old Western PJs and you'd take your wooden bucket and you'd like go get in line and you'd all live in a small town together and you'd all put out the fire. And then if it all was gone or you had to fix it, you'd do like a barn raising day and you'd be like, I have a 2x4, I'll bring that and I'll help. And you would come rebuild the barn together as a community. We laugh about it, but like, I mean, that's a simplification, but that's kind of how it was. Now for the first time, we are exposed to bad news that we are powerless to do anything against. Now put that into a phone in your front right pocket with news alerts and feeds and digital clickbaity, you know, journalism like infected by capitalism, and we are just literally inundated. And so what most of us do is maybe certain personality, all you Enneagram 8s in the room or whatever, you go on social media, you scream, you try to get somebody else to do something, and there is a place for that. But most of us just like, man, that's a bummer. Okay, and then we go on and we like watch Netflix and go to work that day and we just kind of feel like a tiny bit of guilt and then we just go back to our life. We're paralyzed in the face of all this evil. I think there's another way forward I think there's a way that has a long-standing tradition in the Christian way. I was reading about Mother Teresa, said much about this kind of stuff. We think of Mother Teresa as this like global celebrity. Anybody ever been to her little house? I had the chance to visit it once. It's tiny. I mean, it's like the size of this whole building right here. They're like her and 12 other women just going out every day and serving people they found on the streets. This tiny little work. She's well-known, but the work was not. No giant organization. No institution, just small little work. Another example I think of is André Trocmé. You're familiar with him? He was this French Huguenot pastor in a small French village during World War II. And when the Nazis invaded France, the Gestapo came hunting for any Jews, for the village to give up any Jews in their community. And he was just this like non-well-known, not heroic, just a rural village pastor. And somehow he got his entire parish to band together, the whole town, and to welcome in any Jews that were seeking asylum and refuse to give them up to the Gestapo. Unlike, you know, the stories you hear of hiding people in the attic, this was all like in plain sight. They would do life together, they would just bring them into their homes, and then they would refuse to tell the Gestapo who was who. They're like, yeah, it's our family. It's just our family. And because the entire village did it together, the Gestapo didn't know what to do. Are they gonna kill everyone? They killed one or two, including the pastor's brother-in-law, but everybody else survived. They saved 5,000 Jews. Like one tiny little village. And afterwards, of course, he was asked about this, and you know, he did not think of himself as any kind of spiritual leader or whatever. But he said the most fascinating thing, and this is the line that I come back to a lot. He said this, look hard for ways to make little moves against destructiveness. You know, what many of us do is we look not hard at all for ways to make big moves against destructiveness. And if you're one of the very small number of people, maybe nobody in this room, or one or two of you, who really do have that level of power and influence, then please look hard for ways to make big moves against destructiveness. But for the more ordinary pedestrian people like myself in the room, look hard for ways to make little moves against destructiveness. Going out onto the street of Calcutta every day and finding three people that are dying and saying, do you need water? Do you need bread? Can we love you? Can we pray for you? That's a little move. Fasting every Wednesday and giving $20 to the Salvation Army is a tiny little move. Look for little ways. It's not going to solve income inequality in LA or racial injustice in the United States of America, at least not by itself. But it is inside your power, your influence. Do what you can, not what you can't, as the saying goes. Fasting with almsgiving is a little move against destructiveness. That said, fasting is not always as little as we may imagine. Finally, this type of fasting can enable us to stand against evil and injustice. At a social level, fasting can be, this is not how we think of it, but it can be a loving, nonviolent way to protest with your body and your life itself systemic injustice. Of course, Gandhi made famous the hunger strike in his nonviolent resistance to the British Empire. Less known is that he was inspired by the Sermon on the Mount, Leo Tolstoy, and other Christian intellectuals to that very task, as did Oscar Romero, the Christian intellectual and martyr from El Salvador. Fasting is a way for the powerful to voluntarily align with the powerless, as Jesus did for us. But at a spiritual level, which is a bit more in our paradigm, fasting is a way to stand against what the New Testament calls the principalities and powers that are behind the systems and structures of injustice and evil in our world and age, the demonic energies animating the power structures of the world. To fight this evil, we must turn to prayer. St. Gregory the Great said this, "It is impossible to engage in spiritual conflict without the previous subjugation of the appetite." He, like pretty much all of the saints, saw fasting as a prerequisite for any kind of prayer to break through in your life, your church, your city, your world. There's a long-running kind of tradition in the church of fasting to prepare for what people today would call spiritual warfare. In deliverance ministry, or what our Catholic siblings call exorcism, fasting before a session with someone who is demonized is basically mandatory to purge and purify your soul of sin, to like burn it clean, and to grow in the power and the authority and the anointing of the Spirit of God to, in the language of the New Testament, to tear down strongholds. The fast Isaiah has in mind is one where we stand in solidarity with the poor, we share our resources, and we stand against evil and injustice. This last type of fasting will have an effect not just on you or on me, but on our community and on the church as a whole. Remember Jesus' vision. If you're new to the Gospels, go read the Gospel of Mark. Remember Jesus' vision for what the church is meant to be, a new kind of family. And in the same way that in a healthy family, there is no way that anyone would go without food or shelter or the basic necessities of life, as long as there are resources at disposal in the family as a whole. So too, in a healthy church family like yours and ours, there is no way that anyone would go without food or shelter or access to the basic necessities of life. And this is one way of like framing the gospel itself. You have been, this is all New Testament kind of imagery, you and I have been adopted into not just a relationship with God the Father, but into his family. We now have the wealth and the resources of the family of God around us to guard and to guide our life. And while all families fall short of this ideal, mine certainly does. Fasting is one of the best practices we have to co-create a new family with Jesus, where it can be said, as it was said of the early church, there is no needy person among them. And listen, I get this is hard, and I'm just moved here, and I'm trying to figure out, I mean, like just even the geographic challenge of the, we live so separated from each other based on how much money we make and the way the world has kind of turned. Most of the people that are your neighbors are all people in a similar income stream to you. I get this is hard. And I'm not like the person with a bleeding heart for this. I'm introverted. I'd be very happy to just stay home from karaoke night and read a book. I'm very happy all by myself doing my thing. This is not like something that is coming out of me, but I cannot read scripture and not have this just come off page after page after page. And below my apathy and all the questions I have about how to do this in a city like LA and I'm just trying to pay for my own teenagers, underneath all of that, there is this quiet undercurrent of the Spirit of God at work in me, like he is at work in you, moving my heart in a different trajectory than my neighbors, up and to the right. More, more, more. A different trajectory, not of investment, but divestment. Not of getting, but of giving. Not of more, but how do I share out of the abundance of the generosity of God toward me? And I don't want to silence that impulse of the Spirit. I don't want to suppress it. I do it all the time. But I want to tap into that. I want to say yes to that. One of the simplest ways I can do that is just to fast a bit and give the money away. That said, our practice for the final week is similar to the last 3 weeks with one simple addition. It's just to fast one day this week until sundown. We don't have to do it on Wednesday, but we're doing this kind of together. Or the invitation is to join us on Wednesdays as a church. Sundown is defined in the Jewish tradition as when you see the first 3 stars in the sky. But since we live in LA and we can't really see the sky, I'd just go buy your watch. Then the addition this week is to give the money that you would have spent on food to the poor. During your fast day this week, I would invite you, just when you feel that kind of rumble in the tummy, you know, when you feel that hunger pain come, just turn, just take that moment. Let your soul, let your whole person just sink into. This is how millions of people feel all around the world. And then the idea would be just to take the money that you would have spent and give it away. So we'll put in this week's kind of church email a link to the Salvation Army. You can donate directly to their food bank. Like, this is where we as a church serve. This is around the corner. This is right here. Or you may have another nonprofit on your heart, or you may know people in need and you can just Venmo them or drop off groceries or do something anonymous. Just let your heart be filled with joy as you share in that way. And then the reach exercise for this week, if some of you want to even go beyond that, would be not just to donate your money, but to donate your time, to find somewhere to serve, to go serve at the Salvation Army, or to find a local place to serve, or just find somebody in your network of relationships you know, an elderly person maybe, that just go over and do some yard work. You don't need to post this on Instagram. We get it. You're awesome. You can do this, and just in the quiet of your heart, and just find the joy in the act itself. And as you do it, you may just want to ask God, just quietly offer it to God and say, God, would you give me your heart? I don't really have your heart. These people I still see as other. I don't see these people as family yet. Would you give me your heart? Finally, we are finishing our recommended reading, God's Chosen Fast by Arthur Wallace, if you'd like to finish that up with us. But now we come to the end of this practice. I have done my very best in my own very human and failing way over the last few weeks to lay out a vision of fasting as one of the most powerful and essential of all the practices of Jesus, and I think it's the most neglected in the modern Western church. It has the potential to transform our relationship to Jesus, to our body, to God, and to the poor. It can do all of this and more. And our hope, of course, is not just that you kind of dink around with it for a few weeks and then forget about it, but our hope would be that you begin to integrate it into your ongoing life with God and begin just to build this into the way that you follow Jesus, as most Christians have for most of church history. You know, if you were to visit a church in 250 AD in, Hippo, or 1250 AD in France or wherever, you most likely would have noticed the same basic pattern: eating, fasting, and feasting. Followers of Jesus would eat modestly on most days. It was not a kind of abundance world like we live in now. They would fast every Wednesday and Friday until sundown and give their money to the poor. And they would feast every single Sabbath. And of course, the church leaders all kept adding feast days in the liturgical calendar. So it was like Sabbath and this. And like some calendars, like in the Eastern church, it's like 200 feast days a year. I'm like, yeah, my people. Somebody put an Enneagram 7 in charge. Thank you, Gary Jones. But this pattern of eating, fasting, and feasting, it's kind of just a long-standing, healthy way of being for followers of Jesus. It's no secret we Americans prefer feasting to fasting. Yet the two live in a reciprocal relationship. Marva Dawn, in her work on feasting on the Sabbath, writes this: Americans do not know, this is kind of mean, by the way, Americans do not know how to feast because they do not know how to fast. Especially if we fast on behalf of those who don't have enough and share our plenty with them, what we're talking about, our feasting will be much more meaningful. I think the invitation of our spiritual ancestors, followers of Jesus who have gone before us, would be to join them in this basic life rhythm of eating, fasting, and feasting. But let me leave you with this simple thought. You know, fasting is temporary, but feasting is eternal. The story of Scripture begins, arguably, depending on how you read the story, with a fast. A number of the church fathers and mothers point out that the first command in Scripture in Genesis 3 is to not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But Scripture ends with all of this kind of imagery of the trees and kind of a new garden-like city, but it ends not with a prohibition, not with a fast, but with a feast, with God the Father and every tribe and tongue and nation around the table with Jesus just partying hard. No more fasting, no more hunger, no more poor because there is no more poverty, no more standing in solidarity with the poor because there are no more poor. When we feast, when you get together with your vintage community, or I did it Friday night, when we get together, when I sit with the Joneses around our Sabbath table and we feast. We open a bottle of wine, we make sourdough bread, and we do all the things, and we laugh, and we tell stories, and we celebrate life. We are acting out an advance sign of our glorious future. We're just living in microcosm, this little just taste, literal taste, of what eternity will be like with Jesus in the kingdom. And when we fast, we pray with our bodies for God to drag that future into the present. We pray without words, in the language of the early church, Maranatha, or come, Lord Jesus. We hunger, we thirst, we ache for you to come and return. So, may you fast, and may you feast, and may we together invite Jesus to return and set the table for life in the kingdom of God.